serenade me softly, whisper in my ear, good night. Sweet sensations tingle through my spine. What else could you make me wanna believe? I believe I'm gonna fly. Walk through honey, the air turns me to stone. When I'm unwanted in my own damn home. Transformations underneath our skin. From start to finish, I wanted to be here, but you came here to win. Slap me awake and I'll cry. The ink is blocking colors in the sky. Kiss me to sleep and I'll die. I'll wake up in the morning, but not at home. My skin is pale, my hands are cold. Your mirror's cracked and my garden's overgrown. My tears are gray and your blood. Pretty girls in skinny jeans, but I'm sitting on the couch, got a rollie in my mouth. Only thing I'm thinking about is green. Stolen, bruised hearts, no one knows who stole from who. But if I could point a hand at a guilty looking man, God knows it would be you. Slap me awake and I'll cry. The ink is blocking colors in the sky above. Kiss me to sleep and I'll die. I'll wake up in the morning but not at home. My skin is pale, my hands are cold. Your mirror's crashed and my garden's overgrown. My tears
to welcome Dr. Moya O'Brien to FETFest and Wellbeing Wednesday. Dr. Moya O'Brien is a clinical psychologist and co-founder of ICEP Europe. Moya has designed and co-authored several of ICEP Europe's online programs, including Teaching Happiness and Teaching Hope and Optimism. She's involved in ongoing research in the area of resilience, as well as the new H2020 funded project Go Green Roots, an innovative new program aimed at harnessing nature connection to promote resilience and well-being in urban settings. We underestimate the importance of connecting with nature in developing and maintaining our well-being and boosting our resilience. Never in our lives has this been more important given the current COVID-19 crisis. Interestingly, though, the pandemic has allowed some time to stop and reflect on nature and spend more time outdoors. This presentation will examine the relationship of resilience and nature connection in everyday life. There'll be some time for questions at the end, so please pop them in the comments and enjoy the session. Thank you.
Thanks, Wendy, for that introduction. I'm just going to share my screen here and we get started? Okay, so I just want to give you a little bit of background here. My journey and my interest in working in nature and with nature-based solutions in terms of promoting people's mental health. So I'm a clinical psychologist by background, have worked both in Ireland and the US, and mainly worked in Ireland in the CAM services with young people, with children and young people and families. And nearly 20 years ago now, my friend and colleague, Deirdre McIntyre and myself, we set up ICEP Europe. The idea being that we wanted to fast track skills into classrooms. So working mainly with teachers to empower teachers and give them skills necessary to work with various young people with diverse populations that were in the school system. And in 2008, we were looking at, I suppose it was a depressing time really, because the crash in Ireland. And what tends to happen if there's something major going on in society, children and young people bring that into schools with them. The stress that's in the community, in families, it all comes into the schools. So we started looking at answers and solutions really to support teachers and to help them support the young people they were working with. And as part of that, we went down the route of positive psychology. Now, positive psychology is a branch of psychology that's concerned with helping people to flourish, to be their best self, to enjoy life, to experience well-being and happiness. And initially, I thought initially, and I'm sure you may think also, well, is that very washy, wishy-washy? But actually, there's really good science behind it. And I'll be integrating that science throughout this talk and explaining how some of the positive psychology interventions fit very well with nature and how we can use that to enhance our own well-being. So what I'm going to do is talk to you a little bit about the research and what we know about nature as therapy and nature as an intervention, then talk to you a little bit about different strategies that have been used across the globe in communities, but also look at individuals and how they're using nature to enhance their own well-being and reduce their stress. And then maybe challenge you a little bit to think about your connection to nature and how that might be beneficial and help you with your everyday life. So nature as therapy, it's fantastic. There's no side effects. It's readily available to most people. It decreases your stress and it improves your ability to think. And the great thing about it is that it's absolutely free. There's no cost to getting out there in nature. For a long, long time, going way back, you know, there's documents regarding famous authors, philosophers, musicians going out into nature for inspiration. Because we know that being in nature is good for both your mind and your body. In some tribes, it's used as a rite of passage, and that's going way back. But we also know that monks would have used nature as a retreat to go off and meditate, to find peace and calm, and to come back refreshed and restored. In Japan, for instance, there's a whole forest, a whole community of forest bathers who go out just to, again, for that restoration, relaxation, to get what they can from nature to enhance and rebuild themselves and come back stronger and more capable. One of the interesting things that came out of 9/11 was there was an increased use of parks following 9/11. And I think this is very relevant for us. And I'll talk a little bit about some of the Irish data in a moment about COVID-19. While it's not the same thing at all, during COVID-19, we also would have used nature to enhance our well-being and to support us. And I'll go into more detail in a few minutes on that. Unfortunately, we have to mention COVID-19. Everybody's a bit tired and weary of it at this stage. Some of us have been more fortunate than others, where it hasn't actually impacted on our families or friends, but other people have had devastating loss during this time. And we do need to acknowledge those individuals, many of whom will work in frontline services. But our life, all of our lives have been upended and changed. We're living with risk and uncertainty, particularly, I suppose, this time last year. There was an awful lot of anxiety, an awful lot of worry about older members of your family, more vulnerable members of your family. When was this going to end? When were we going to be able to meet people? And all of that was going on. We now have a little bit of hope with the vaccine, and things have lifted slightly. So we're in a better position, but it has been a severely challenging year for all of us. I think if you stand back and look at some of the positives, though, from lockdown, systems have been disrupted. Many of you are either attending education or working in the education setting. I did not think that in my lifetime I would see education change as much as it did. Very quickly, the leaving cert was re-envisaged and rolled out. Something that I never would have thought possible in that short time. The health service have also accelerated their change. You know, they've been able to roll out vaccines. They've been able to equip themselves to deal with this challenge that was in front of us. But also, and again, this is when you talk, when you look at positive psychology, we talk about transformative opportunities. So how can we come back stronger from this? And I think there are many transformative opportunities from COVID-19. One of the big things is that our value system has been turned around slightly. We've placed huge value now on our frontline workers. Teachers, frontline workers, they've all been acknowledged for the contribution that they're making. Parents too have been included as partners in the education process. And I think that that's quite different. And hopefully we can learn from that and harness some of that energy also. A big thing for me though is the conversations around wellbeing. There's many, many different voices contributing both at a national and at a local level to these conversations on wellbeing and encouraging young people to talk about their own wellbeing and the impact that COVID-19, the challenge that it has presented. But also too, another transformative opportunity is our connection with nature, which is the topic of our talk today. We've had more time to notice nature, to get out into nature and to be a part of nature. And that can be quite transformative. Also, nature has had a little bit of a chance to recover because there hasn't been as much traffic or as much disruption. So I think that's one of the positive aspects, if you like, of this situation that we've all survived over the last 12 months. So the other thing which I mentioned earlier is that we have embraced the outdoors. I mean, I think these statistics are phenomenal. Quilche, you know, have said 2.2 million people have visited forests between February and December 2020. Like, that's staggering. Sports Ireland Monitor also did a piece of research. They are saying that 500,000 more people are regularly walking out in nature. 220,000 people are out there cycling, and that there's been a decrease in inactive adults. So we're all getting out there, we're embracing nature, we're taking up walking, cycling, just getting out and about. And we're doing this because at some level we know that it is good for our well-being and for our mental health. And this has actually been backed up by research. So the UK Mental Health Foundation did a survey, and 45% of individuals said that visiting green spaces such as parks had helped them cope with COVID-19. So visiting and noticing nature was important to their well-being. So our connection with nature is vital in this time to help us unlock mental health benefits and give us clues as to how we can maximize these benefits and take them with us into the future. How exactly then does this work, our connection with nature? My colleague, Hyde McIntyre, who works with us on the Go Green Roots project, he actually heads up the Go Green Roots project. He's a sports psychologist, but he put together this diagram, which I think sums it all up. So there's actually a cyclical process going on. So when you interact with nature, it's good for your emotions, it's good for your thinking, it's good for your social connection, and it's good for your health, your heart and your physical health. When you connect with nature, you also can become more concerned about our environment and preserving our environment because you have an attachment to that environment. And so it all goes round in a circle. So you do more, the more you get out there, the more you connect, the more there's these spin-off benefits for you. But when I talk about nature connection, I'm talking about how we feel emotionally connected to the natural world. So it's not just having contact with nature, and I'll go into more detail about this in a few moments. It's about encompassing how we feel, think, and experience our relationship with the natural environment. So it's much deeper than just getting out into nature. It's about that deep connection and how we can develop that deep connection with nature. So nature is actually a new model for well-being, okay? The more we get out into nature, the better our physical health, the better our mental health, and the more connection we have to nature, the more likely we are to look after nature and the more likely we are to go out again into nature. But it has been proven in the research, Capaldi in 2014, he said that the connection to nature is as important for well-being as other factors that we would know for a long time, such as income and education. We're not 100% sure about the mechanisms and why nature is so good for us, but there have been a number of different theories. Some of them simply state, look at, you know, none of us are that far removed from farming backgrounds and being out on the land. And so it's almost a survival thing that when we're out in nature, you know, we know that, you know, we have what we need, we can survive. And that helps to reduce our stress. There's other theories such as attention restoration, which simply says that when you go out in nature, it gives us a chance to pause, to be in the quiet, open space, and for to reset, if you like, what we focus our attention on. There's even more research on this, which is fascinating, I think. Like if you're out in nature and you're actually looking at light coming through the trees, that impacts the perception of the light coming through the trees, impacts on how your brain functions. And supports this kind of a relaxation or restorative calming mechanism in your body. So again, you know, there's interesting things on emotion and behavior, and one of the fascinating things that I love about nature is it's one of the few places where we can experience all. And there's very few times in our life that we can experience all, but getting out into nature is one of those things that we can do to generate these feelings of awe. Many people will experience awe at the birth of a baby or observing the birth of an animal, or but also natural, looking at an amazing waterfall, standing on the precipice of the Grand Canyon. All of those things can generate awe, and all of these positive emotions are hugely important. I like to think of them as an emotional reset button. So when you're in nature, you have this cascade of positive emotions, and that helps to reset us. So you know yourself, when you're in good humor, when things are going well, when you're feeling very positive, it's easy to try something new. It's easy to get on well with your colleagues, with your family, with your friends. The opposite is also true, though. When you're experiencing very negative emotions, you get very closed down. And like that's, if any of you have experience of depression or a family member with depression, their thinking becomes very closed, very black and white. They can only see one option. They can't explore multiple options. They can't be open. They can't be creative. They find it difficult to connect. So positive emotions help us to cultivate openness, creativity, connection, generosity, and resilience. And again, the positive psychology theorists would tell us that all of these things can act to reset our emotions and to help us bounce back from negative experiences, but also to allow us to take on new opportunities and bounce forward onto new opportunities. And one of the pieces of research in this area by Keltner in 2017, even watching a clip from planet Earth increased awe and gratitude in people. So while it's not exactly as good as been out and been exposed to nature, actually watching some of these nature programs can also shift and help us generate this awe and gratitude. The whole thing about awe really is that it makes us realize that we're part of something bigger, and it dissolves boundaries, and that gives us a huge freedom. There was another fascinating experiment where actually after exposure to nature images, people gave more money to a stranger. So it does help us to be more open, to be more generous. And when we do an act of kindness like that, again, we know from positive psychology that helps us to feel good about ourselves. So it all builds and creates off each other. So nature creates positive emotion. And on the left side here, you know, I list some of these positive emotions that nature can create. Awe, gratitude, compassion, appreciation, inspiration, admiration, elevation, and love. And it helps us to transcend our own needs and foster healthy social relationships. But it also binds people together. I mean, if you've had some amazing experience outdoors where you've seen something incredible, you feel very close to the people that are with you. And this is because of the hormones, some oxytocin and various hormones that are flooding through our body when we're experiencing these positive emotions. So you feel that social connection and you feel closer to those people that are with you. Nature can answer various problems of people living in groups, you know, and helping to build that community, build that creativity, build that generosity and that kindness. Nature induces us to be kind and altruistic, and that increases our positive emotion. Now, there has been work done on various neighbourhoods and nature, close to nature in various neighbourhoods. And we know that there was one study done, for instance, in Chicago, and people who live near green spaces, such as lawns or parks or trees, they experience greater calm, a stronger sense of connection to their neighbours, more civility and less violence. So, you know, again, I think all of these factors do need to be considered at multiple levels across multiple disciplines in order to support people's connection and access to natural environments. And again, we know that nature has huge benefits. Each one of these is a study that proves that nature will improve our health. It can lower hypertension. It has huge knock-on effects for our physical health, but also our psychological health in terms of restoration and mental well-being. Can reduce, and again, I'll talk a little bit about some of the research on depression and anxiety in a while, improve just our self-esteem, our mood, our confidence. And you know that yourself, if you get out just for a quick walk, it can actually boost your mood, help you to reset. So reconnecting with nature has immense benefits. And it can give us a sense of purpose, of energy and joy. Nature can also be a buffer to stress. So again, there's research from the US and from the Netherlands that nature shields us from stress, and it has a role in resilience. It can help us to bounce back from stressful events, and it can create this positive emotion, which we know is attached to bouncing back and resilience. It can make us be optimistic. It can help us have hope for the future. But another thing it can do is it can impact on our perception of time. So there's been studies done where people went for a walk in a man-made environment and a walk in nature. And the ones that went for the walk in nature, they had this expanded sense of time. So I think that's another huge benefit of getting out in nature to decrease our stress and buffer our stress. I just want to play this video now for you, which is it's a video of Neve Briggs. She's the University of Limerick Bohemian Women's team coach at the moment. She has a dual career as a Garda and an athlete, and she was nominated for the World Player of the Year Rugby in 2014 when Ireland's women's team defeated the All Blacks. And this video was made a number of years ago for another piece of work we were doing with my colleague Clyde McIntyre, who's a sports psychologist, on resilience and recovering and using nature to recover from sports injuries. And in particular, examining the impact for athletes of using nature to come back from these types of injuries. So I'll just play this short video for you and of Neve talking about using nature.
To come out here because it reminds me of home. I grew up on the water and I love it because never the same 2 days in a row. The sounds and the peacefulness of it is something that attracts me to it most. I love the calmness. I love the fact that as I said, my life is so hectic and everything is a million miles an hour, and I think that when I get to come out here it's everything is slowed down and I get to control the pace of it. And I'm from Abbeyside, a small village in Waterford, and my home house is on a beach, and we spend all our time down there. It just relaxes me totally, body and mind. But also when I've been away from home for a long time and I come out somewhere like this, it just reminds me of home and brings me back there. So sometimes when you play a contact sport like rugby, or it's all about the go-go, it's about the 100 million miles an hour of every gym session and every running session and every contact session. It's all bish bash, and when you come out to something like this, it's different. It's just another take on it, I think. Whether you're swimming or paddling or whatever it is, it's just another mindset of you're still active, you're still out there, you're still getting into something that you really want to do, but it's away from that kind of core contact and heaviness that's probably associated with rugby. It gives you a chance to take a deep breath and get perspective on things, and it just allows you to try and probably solve problems without being in the hustle and bustle of your own environment. Personally, given the last year over with all the injuries and stuff, it's been really important for me to be able to come out and just get perspective on, my work and rugby, not the be all and end all, and how you cope with it. And I think that it's definitely been hugely important for me. I think before I got injured, I wouldn't really have taken much time to understand my thinking. I wouldn't have taken much time away to myself to try and reflect on things and put things in perspective, because everything was just all it was go and it was constant. And I think that when you get something taken away from you, or you can't do something that you really love, you kind of have no choice but to reflect on things. So definitely, coming out here was a huge part of that, and I don't endorse that 100%. I think it's been a huge factor of me being able to cope with the last year in terms of missing out obviously on the World Cup, but also knowing that I'll get back to play rugby again, and it was a huge help to me.
So I think that's, Niamh sums it all up there very well, talking about how she used getting out into nature to help her when she was injured and when things weren't going well for her. I mean, I think she sums it all up there. You get a different perspective. It's quiet, it's calm, you can think, and it's really, I think her little video there is a great, it's a great advertisement for getting back out into nature. So that's at a very individual level. I want to talk now about nature interventions at a much bigger level. So Every Kid Outdoors was an attempt by the American government when Barack Obama came into power as president to get every child back out into nature. So this initiative is fantastic in the US. Every fifth grader can get entrance to a park free and their family free also. And it was so popular that it got extended every year, and it's continuing to this day. But I think it's just a lovely initiative to encourage children and their families to get back out into nature and to explore nature. So by giving free entrance to the parks. Another campaign, this is closer to home. Again, it's Tyke McIntyre was involved in this with Sports Ireland, Tyke was in UL, and Mental Health Ireland. And this took place between April and May last year when we were in our first lockdown. And basically it was to get people out into nature. Nature moves, and it was a campaign on Twitter. So some of the lovely photos that people tweeted are we put them up here to share across the different platforms. So again, I think the variety of nature that people are attracted to is interesting as well. For some people, it's the sea, it's others, it's lakes, others, it's very rural mountains, country lanes. And just to add to that, I'll just talk a little bit about Go Green Roots, which is the current project that we're working on. Again, it was based out of the University of Limerick, but it's across Europe, and there's 18 different partners involved. So the whole idea of Go Green Roots is it's ongoing, obviously, it kicked off last year, is to try to get people to get out into their urban area, which is important, it's across cities, but to enjoy green spaces, to enjoy green exercise, to connect with nature, and to get engaged in the project and become part of that. So you'll be hearing more and more about Go Green over the coming months. This is another project which the Wildlife Trust in the UK, they run this every year, and actually it just started on the 1st of June, but they have phenomenal resources on their website. And again, it's about trying to encourage people to get back out into nature, to connect with nature. So they have this campaign called 30 Days Wild, and it runs for the month of June. And last year, they actually pulled together all of the random acts of wildness, which is a kind of a catchy phrase, I think. What people rated, the top 10 that people rated of getting out into the wild last June. So here are some examples. The first, the highest 10 examples there that they got. And that might give you some ideas for getting out yourself and engaging with nature. So these are some of the pictures that you guys sent to us, which thank you so much, of your interactions are your favorite places in nature. And again, you can see quite a wide variety there. Some of them are in Ireland, some of them are a little further afield, but they're all fascinating examples. Some contain animals, some don't. The sea, the fields, the mountains. So I think it's just nice to see what other people value and treasure in our natural environment, because we live in an amazing country, and we have great access to nature and nature all around us. So just in terms of your own interaction with nature, I'd just like you to think about three good things in nature, just for a few seconds. Just think about three things that you find good in nature. I think you might have been, it might be inspired by some of the previous photographs that we put up there, but just think for a moment about those. And maybe even write them down so that you have them at a later point. The reason that I'm asking you to do that is there's some amazing researchers out of the University of Derby. So Miles Richardson, who has blogs on nature, and if you're into nature, he's really worth looking up. But also David Sheffield, and these guys, they have very sound research on nature and nature's impact on us as individuals. So the three good things is actually an idea that came from positive psychology. And as I said, I'd be interweaving some positive psychology ideas throughout this talk. So in positive psychology, writing down three good things every day does have an impact and boosts your mood. But Richardson and Sheffield wanted to see if this would work when they asked people to write down three good things that they noticed in nature over 5 days. And the results, they wanted to see if this would increase nature connection. So they had a control group, which were just asked to write down three things every day. For example, three items in their kitchen every day. And the other group were writing down three things they noticed in nature every day. And there was a significant increase in nature connection for the people that were writing down the three things they noticed in nature, but also there was health improvements for this group and an improvement in their overall positive emotion. So again, it's just a very simple intervention that you might want to try yourself, very easy to do, keep track of three good things in nature every day and see if you notice a change, a boost in your own well-being. Some of these researchers are doing really phenomenal things in terms of the linking technology and mobile technology and looking at nature and people's experiences in nature and what that does to their actual mood and overall subjective well-being. So this is a massive study that was done in 2013, and these types of studies continue today, but 20,000 people, and they got 1 million responses. So what they did was they sent people a questionnaire, a very brief couple of questions on their mobile phone. They were able to track GPS location, so they knew if these people were outdoors in a green or natural habitat, or if they were in an urban environment. And so they were able to match the responses and where the person actually was. And, you know, it's again, based on what we've heard before, people that were outdoors were significantly and substantially happy than people that than that particular person when they were in an urban environment. So again, it's another validation, really, of the impact of being out and our mental health. Another piece of research that backs this up, moving to a green space. So they tracked people in the UK over 5 years, and people that moved to a green space or an area where they had a lot of green space around them, they had better mental health over a 3-year time period. So that's certainly something to consider if you want to improve your mental health. But this has much more serious implications as well. So there's a whole school of thought now that talk about nature-based interventions, nature-based solutions. And that's a group of people that are working with people with serious difficulties, so with significant mental health issues. So if you Google green care, it's quite popular in the UK. And what it's about is about prescribing nature-based interventions, right? Now, it isn't the panacea to everything, but some of the research is quite promising. So asking people to get outdoors, engaging in nature, walking, working on a conservation project, managing woodlands over a 12-week program. And what they did was they had small groups of people, 2 to 3 hours a week, engaged in these activities. And there was a self-reported almost 70% increase in their well-being from that project. So just getting them out there did have an impact on their well-being. In another study, they divided a group of people with depression. They divided them up. So one group had a 50-minute walk in nature and the other group had a 50-minute walk in an urban area. But they asked them specifically to think about negative events when they were out on their walk. And 1 week later, they reversed the group. So the ones that had been out in nature were now in the urban area and vice versa. And across the board, the nature group showed improvement in thinking, memory and increases in mood. And they would report that they found it difficult to think about this the negative event that they had decided they were going to think about while they were out in nature. So again, more proof that nature can work not just to boost our mental health and to increase our support, our well-being, but also with people who are struggling or have significant difficulties, it can also be a useful intervention. And this is gaining more and more popularity. I think you'll hear much more about it in the future. So I want you to just think about your own connection to nature. Where did that start? What are your early memories? Was that out on a beach? Was it in a forest? Was it in a field? Out on a farm? Or do you even have an early memory? Some people who have been exposed to nature their whole life, maybe growing up on a farm, they can't identify one particular moment or event. But just think about your connection. But I want you to think about actually being immersed in nature, not just been out in nature, but really embracing nature, getting into your senses and what you see and what you hear around you. You can be out in nature and not see anything because, you know, I've done it. You have to actually make a conscious effort to connect with nature. So think about your own connection to nature and how you might engage with nature to sustain your own well-being. I'd like you to try and think of some ideas that you can use over the coming weeks to increase and harness your connection with nature, both in your work and in your home life. And some of you may already be very well immersed in nature, be very well connected, but some of you may want to increase that connection. And some of you may want to start again and actually go out there and engage with nature at a different level. So again, from the research, we know that when you're in nature, you need to direct your attention to some specific aspect of nature. So whether that's the trees, the birds, the flowers, the singing, the noise, the sounds of the birds singing around you, whatever that might be, to actually direct your attention when you're out in nature, but also bring that home with you and savor those activities later on. So that might be writing down those three good things, reliving that experience that you had earlier in the day when you were out in nature, whether that was looking at a beautiful flower or listening to the bird singing, whatever that might be. It might have been some more strenuous activity. It might have been out for a jog, but again, or for a swim. Again, it's about the sensation. It's about using the here and the now, almost like meditation, if you like, to actually savor that activity when you're doing it, but also after when the activity is finished. So just building your own connection with nature, you can do that in a number of different ways. I think I've convinced you that it is good for your mental health, for your well-being, for your emotions, for your mood. But thinking about how you can build that connection, whether that's experiencing awe and wonder, is there opportunity to do that? Maybe for you that might be observing a waterfall. It might be climbing a mountain. It might be planning some trip. And for some people who might not be able to get out, it could be just watching some of those massive nature shows that are on television to get that sense of awe and wonder. Savoring natural environments to create that positive emotion. So again, bringing it back home with you, thinking about it, maybe even photographing it. You know, sometimes if we were face to face, we might go out and take a walk around, and I might ask you to photograph some things that catch your eye in nature, and share them with us, and why you found them interesting or positive, or why you found that particular image captivating. But unfortunately, we're online. So, but think about those things. Another activity that we often do is ask people to look for hope in nature, to photograph hope in nature. And again, sometimes you'll see a little crack in a pavement where there's a lovely flower grown. It's not supposed to be grown there. You don't know how it's grown there. But for me, that would be a symbol of hope in nature. Establish your safe place in nature. Again, not everybody will like the water. Not everybody will like the mountains. But think about what's your safe place in nature. Where can you go to feel restored, to feel that you're rested, that your attention is restored. Sometimes even sharing knowledge and folklore, and Ireland is a great place for that. Knowledge about the land, about nature. I know that even in in farms, for instance, they have names for different fields that came down through generations. Activities like that can also help to increase your connection with nature, and combine nature with creativity. So some of you may be very creative, you may be arty, you may like to go out and paint in nature, but think of how you can interweave nature with your own creativity. And finally, how we can work towards protecting nature, whether that's in your own back garden, whether it's in your own county, whether it's in the whole of Ireland, but thinking about how we can protect nature. I think all of us have seen an increase in nature with the reduction of cars on the road in terms of animals and animal life. And I know that there's reports of birds have been heard and seen that haven't been seen in a while. So I think all of that, again, is quite a positive impact of one of the transformations of COVID-19. So again, just thinking about what you're going to bring with you from COVID-19. I know that I hope to bring with me some of this, some of the connection that I have to nature at the moment. I've had the privilege of working from home, so I've been trying to get out at lunchtime. I have a canal nearby, walking down the canal. I want to try and hold on to some of that connection as we move into the future. So I'm going to just wrap it up there. I'm going to have time for questions. If anyone would like to ask any, please post them on the board. Elaine is going to moderate the question and answer session. And thank you so much for your time and attention this morning. It's been a pleasure to talk with you.
Thank you, Dr. Moya O'Brien. That was excellent. I'll pass it over to you, Elaine.
Yeah, well, we haven't got any questions yet, but we've some lovely comments about people going, going for walks over lockdown, going to the beach, talking about the sky and the sun. A lot of people are referencing water and creativity, resilience, local forests. God, there's lots of stuff. People doing runs in local parks, wildlife ponds. And then there was one here that I might read out, if that's okay, about the memory. So it's from Paula saying that her earliest memory started with her grandparents. Her granddad grew his own hybrid roses and veg for dinner, and her nan used to hold buttercups to her chin. I know my own niece does that actually. And feeding birds from her hands, and nature was her own little world as a child, chatting to ladybirds and playing tunes and blades of grass. So that's such a lovely memory to have. And then more people talking about going for rivers, looking at swans and sunsets. So I think that's it from the comments. I don't know if anybody has any actual questions that they have for Moya.
No, I think we'll leave it there, Elaine. That was brilliant. Thank you, Dr. Moya and Elaine from ICEP. I hope you can all take something positive from today's session and try and get outdoors into nature later today. It's such a beautiful day. I know personally I'm going to try the three good things activity this week on my walks, and I'll get back to you and let you know how it goes. So thank you both so much. That was brilliant.
Thanks a million.
Thank you.
Thanks.
Thanks, everyone.
Now, up next, we have the travel expert. Let me just get my notes here. Okay, so I'm really excited about our next guest. I followed her on Instagram for quite some time, and to be honest, during lockdown, it felt like a real form of escapism to look at her beautiful travel pics. Sarah Slattery is the founder of The Travel Expert, one of Ireland's leading independent travel websites that offers destination advice, travel tips and travel deals to Irish consumers. If you're looking for a last minute deal, even this bank holiday, she has some great offers up on her page, which is thetravelexpert.ie. If you're considering foreign travel later this month, then she has a brilliant blog up on her page with lots of questions and answers and everything you need to know to go abroad. Sarah lives in Dublin with her husband and two children, and she's travelled extensively in Ireland and all over the world. She's 30 years experience in the travel industry and contributes regularly to multiple media outlets. Today, Sarah will take us on a journey around some of Ireland's hidden gems. So if you're looking to escape the crowds this summer and see somewhere different, then this is for you. So thanks, Sarah, for joining us on Wellbeing Wednesday, and I hope you enjoy.
Hello, everyone, and thanks very much for joining me here today. I'm delighted to be asked by the Kildare and Wicklow Education and Training Board to talk to you about some staycations today, and particularly delighted to be part of FETFest's Wellbeing Wednesday, because I suppose for me anyway, and I think for a lot of us, when we think of wellbeing, we think of holidays. And with the country opening up, there's no better time to start talking about staycations and start talking about some of Ireland's hidden gems. I decided for today's presentation to try and not focus on the top attractions and things that you may already be aware of, and instead highlight some of Ireland's hidden gems, a little bit off the beaten track, and places that would be more accessible this summer. So I hope you enjoy my presentation and it gives you some travel inspiration to discover Ireland this summer. So before I get started, I just want to introduce myself and just tell you a little bit about me. So in case you haven't already figured it out yet, my name is Sarah Slattery and I'm the owner of thetravelexpert.ie, which is one of Ireland's leading independent travel websites. It offers advice to consumers about destinations, it offers travel tips and reviews, and focuses on all things travel at home and abroad. But before I started thetravelexpert.ie over 6 years ago now, I was a travel agent. I was actually a travel agent for 24 years, so I've done a lot of travelling throughout my life. I started when I was 18 and travelled as a single person, as a couple, and then obviously later in life with children. So I like to think I have most scenarios covered. When I started The Travel Expert, I originally focused on overseas travel, but I obviously had some articles on holidays in Ireland as well, but as soon as COVID hit, I pivoted the business completely to focus on holidays in Ireland. And I did quite a lot of travelling around Ireland last year when restrictions lifted. and I really found a newfound respect for my own home country and discovered a lot of hidden gems that I didn't realise were actually there. So I'm hoping to share some of those with you today. So just to give you a quick rundown on today and how it's going to go, I'm going to talk briefly about, give you some staycation tips for anyone who hasn't stayed in a hotel during COVID-19. There's just some things that I thought you should be aware of. And then I'm going to talk briefly about four different regions in Ireland and just some of the hidden gems that are available there and some of the top attractions that you might be able to see this summer. So some staycation tips. Last year, one of the things we noticed when we were travelling around Ireland during COVID was the difference between restrictions from hotel to hotel. They really varied quite a lot. So one of the most important things I would recommend you do is before you, well, either before you book or certainly before you go, is to check out what the restrictions are in the particular hotel you're visiting. Some hotels will be make a conscious effort not to have their staff interact with you. So you may find that they may not clean your room, they may not change your towels, make up your beds, things like that. They also may restrict the number of times they come over to you during meal time. So for instance, that you may find they're not topping up your wine glass or cleaning your places quickly, things like that. But it may just actually be the hotel's policy. So before you feel that you're not getting the service you deserve, maybe just check with the hotel to find out what their standards are. And once you explain to them that if you want your room cleaned or you want your towels changed, I'm sure they'll be quite happy to do that. It's just a matter of speaking to them beforehand and letting them know what suits you best. Speaking about booking, actually, I see on the one of my top tips there about booking sites. If you haven't already booked yet, there's lots of different, obviously hotels are going to say book with us directly, and of course in many cases they tend to be, that tends to be the best way to go. Sometimes they'll offer spa treatments included or meals included and things like that, but certainly from a research point of view, I found that a lot of the booking sites like booking.com or hotels.com, Expedia, things like that, are great for research because you may be looking for a particular hotel that's not available, but it will show you up a lot of alternatives. So it's a quick and easy way to find out what's available, a general price point in the area you're looking to go to. I have lots of similar articles and prices on my website as well, but generally sometimes you may want to book via those sites or you may want to book through the hotel directly. But whatever way you book, one thing you need to watch out for is free cancellation. So luckily, most hotels are offering free cancellation now, so it's not as rare as it used to be. But you just don't know whether you may have to, you know, something may happen at the last minute that you need to cancel, or you may not be happy with some of the COVID policies in place. So just make sure you have that safety net when you are booking. About 48 hours before is when the hotels recommend, but I'd even probably go as far as to say maybe before that. I try and pre-book your swimming pool slots, pre-book your spa treatments, anything like that, even restaurant times, breakfast times. Everything sort of needs to be pre-booked now during COVID. And while this might sound like it's the spontaneity's kind of gone out of it a little bit, but it can be a huge advantage because particularly if you're booking attractions, it's nice sometimes to have things pre-booked because you tend to make you do things you may otherwise decide, oh sure, look, let's lie on a bed for another hour or let's not bother today, the weather isn't looking great. So at least if you have things pre-booked, it kind of makes you do them, which is I actually think is quite a good thing. But just check your restaurant times because some hotels and some restaurants will have, you know, you only have a certain amount of time. If they have minimum social distancing or minimum space in the restaurants, you may only have 90 minutes. Other hotels or restaurants might give you longer. So check that because sometimes it can be a benefit to book the last sitting in a restaurant, which means you usually should get a little bit more time there. The same thing kind of goes with all attractions. So as well as booking hotel meal times and spa treats and that, I'd also make sure you book attractions in the local area as well. And lastly, just I have a little help from Google there. Most of us don't need any introduction to Google Maps. We all know them, have been using them for years, but most people still I talk to still have the old Google Map app on their phone. So make sure you download the new app. It came out about a year ago, I think. It's called the Google Food and Transit app. And it not only will it obviously have the traditional Google Maps features, but it also has a great Explore tab, which allows you to look up hidden gems, reviews from people who have been in the local area. And it also lets you create lists. The lists function is really handy, particularly if you're not traveling till July or August and you meet somebody now who tells you about this great restaurant in Mayo or hidden gem beach in Galway. So you can put that into your phone, into the app, and when you're near that area on your travels a month later or 2 months later, it'll show you that you're near this place that's high on your wish list. It's also worth noting that some parts of Ireland, like if you're in the Inishowen Peninsula or some remote parts of the country, the coverage, the network coverage may not be what you're used to. So I would always recommend downloading your Google Maps. So if there's a road trip or a place you particularly want to go, download the map beforehand so that you can use it offline when you are there, just in case the coverage isn't good. So yeah, that's that Google Maps app. It's called Google Food and Transit. And I would recommend you download that before you go off on your staycation this year. So let's get started and I'll start covering Ireland's ancient East first. So most of you will be very familiar with the Boyne Valley. I probably don't need to tell you a huge amount about it, but there are just a few things that you may not be aware of. We all know about Taylor Park and Newgrange and most of its top attractions, but the Boyne Blueway has 35 kilometres of rivers. And with a lot of people looking for water-based activities this year, there's plenty available on the Boyne Blueway. Boyne Valley activities offer kayaking and canoeing, both guided and unguided tours. And you know, you're canoeing through castles and under bridges, and it's a really beautiful part of the country to do that. There's also Boyne boats, which if you want a more relaxing experience, they will bring you out on their traditional Irish curraghs, the same curraghs that were used in the Game of Thrones. And the owner was actually on set for the Game of Thrones. So he will give you some great insights of what it was like to be on set, and also has some great stories. He's a really good storyteller and great stories about the Battle of the Boyne and things like that. So that's just a really nice sort of experience for families, or if you just want to relax and enjoy it. Another thing that most people are not aware of is that the Boyne Valley has its own Camino. So it's a 25 kilometre looped walk in County Louth, and it is officially recognised as part of the official Camino. So if you wanted to do the Camino in Spain, for instance, and you need to walk the 100 kilometres to get the official pilgrim certificate, if you walk the 25 kilometre route here in Louth and get your passport stamped along the way, you'll need to get your passport in advance. But if you get it stamped along the way, you'll only have to do 75 kilometres then in Spain to get the official certificate. So I suppose with everybody out walking so much lately, it's something really interesting to do. And it's so close to Dublin, Kildare, Wicklow, as you know yourself. Also, this particular region, there's lots of great hotels and accommodation options, and the prices are really good value. Dunboyne Castle is great value for a four-star hotel. There's great glamping at Rock Farms Lane. And there's just a lot of different options there that would be a lot more reasonably priced than if you were trying to stay along the Atlantic coast, for instance. So moving on to Kilkenny now. We visited Kilkenny last summer and absolutely loved it. And I suppose when I think of Kilkenny, or when I thought of Kilkenny before, I always thought of culture and heritage and some of its great restaurants. And yes, it has all of that, of course, but there's also so many outdoor activities available. River Barrow, there's a company there called Go With The Flow. They're multi-award winning. You just have to look at their reviews on TripAdvisor. They offer great canoeing trips down the Barrow and whitewater rafting trips as well. They also do wild camping experiences. So they'll set you off with your canoe and your tent and your life jacket, and off you go for 2 days and tell you where to wild camp along the way. Some really, really interesting trips with them. And Pure Adventure are another company that offer supping, which is the latest craze, or the fastest growing water sport, I believe, in the world at the moment. And it's a beautiful, idyllic. You can see in the photo there, the second picture there at Greignamana. It's a really lovely place to try it. The thing about supping as well is it's a lot easier to try it on lakes where the water is calmer, or rivers, than it is in the surf, say in Mayo or Clare or somewhere like that. So yeah, if you haven't tried it before, it could be a really good place to start. Another place we visited last year was Castlecomer Discovery Park, which is absolutely fantastic if you have kids. Ireland's longest zip line is there. There's also paddle boats, archery. I mean, there's so many different things to do. And I love that you can go into the park and it's free of charge to enter. There's fairy trails and things like that for younger kids. And then you just pay for the activity as you want it, so you can do as little or as much as you like. And finally there, something really unique we did in Kilkenny last year was a falconry experience. It was a private tour that was arranged with Hawkeye Falconry. They work out of Lairath Estate, but he would go to any of the hotels that you're staying in the area in Kilkenny or Waterford. And it's absolutely a fabulous experience, definitely one I can highly recommend. It's private, so everybody in your family can get to walk with the hawks. And it's, yeah, definitely one of those that we, for memories, kids are still talking about it, actually. So just to remind you, my talk today is on Ireland's hidden gems. And certainly Cavan has a few of these that I'm pretty sure most of you didn't know about. The first place I'm going to talk about is something a little bit different. It's the Cavan County Museum, which is the largest outdoor replica World War I trench in Ireland and the UK. Not obviously something for everybody, but for any history buffs out there, my husband is one of them anyway, who's fascinated with World War I. It's something really interesting. It's interactive, and also for teens who are covering that area in school, maybe it's something really interesting to try. Also, lots of free parks in Cavan. Doonery Forest Parks has lots of a dramatic gorge and loads of lovely walks. And the Cavan Burn Park is free to enter too. And there's an interpretive centre there, loads of walking trails. And something about Cavan, there's some lovely accommodation that just opened there last year called Caboo Cabins. They're sort of luxury self-catering cabins that a lot of people aren't aware of. They're sort of, there's houses and cabins, log cabins beside a lake, so you can do some boating activities, there's forest trails. If you're looking for something sort of really luxury, self-catering off the beaten track, check out the Caboo Cabins. So Wexford probably doesn't need much introduction either. I'm not so sure it's one of our hidden gems, but just to point out, with so many people looking for the west coast and the beaches on the west coast of Ireland, Wexford is 275 kilometres of coastline, so it is a really good alternative to the Wild Atlantic Way. And the Hookhead Peninsula is one of my personal favourite areas. The Hookhead Lighthouse is spectacular. Anyway, it's the oldest operational lighthouse in the world, so that's definitely, probably goes without saying, that's worth visiting. But all along that coastline, there's some beautiful walks. The new coastal cliff walk has opened this year from Arthurstown down to Duncannon Beach. And there's lots of hidden gem beaches along the way, Dollar Bay and places like that, that are definitely should be discovered. You have to kind of climb over sand dunes and all that to find them. And the thing about Hookhead Peninsula, there's a lot of water-based activities down there. Hooked do kite surfing lessons. So if you have teens or something like that looking for something a little bit different this summer, you can do kite surfing lessons down there. And the Irish Experience offers like sea cave kayaking and loads of different water sports all along that peninsula too. Another thing just to point out that is in Wexford is Ireland's only seal rescue centre. They rescued, I think, about 180 seals last year, and they offer free tours. It's a charity run organisation, so definitely worth checking that out too. So moving south down to Cork. So you're spoiled for choice for things to do in Cork, but I just wanted to highlight some of my favourite areas and some things that you may not be aware of. The Berra Peninsula is one of my favourite parts of Ireland, in fact. It's, you know, part of it is in Cork and part of it is in Kerry, but it's certainly one of our most scenic drives. And I would say the colourful towns there of Eyries and Alahees, and the Castletown Bear itself, it's just a really, really beautiful part of the country. Also, Ireland's only cable car is down there on Jersey Island. So you can get from the south of the Berra Peninsula, you can get the cable car over to Jersey Island if you look for something really different and really remote. Another part I have mentioned down there is Cove, which isn't on the Barra Peninsula, but just to highlight Cove as a destination. Most people, when they think of attractions in Cork, particularly for families, they'll think of Fota Wildlife Park, which is there. But Cove is also home to Spike Island, which is Ireland's top attraction, or Cork's top attraction, according to TripAdvisor. So that is definitely well worth visiting, the old prison. I think it's our own little Alcatraz we have down there. Also, the Titanic experiences in Cove. So it's a really nice destination in itself. There's a lot to do around that area. I've mentioned the Fota VIP family experience there because so many people visit Fota, but very few do the family experience, the VIP family experience. Now, it's not cheap. I think it's about €160. If you want to maybe double check that price. But it's a private guided tour. You get to feed the animals. You get to learn all the insights with a guide. And it's we did it about, I'd say, 5 years ago now, and the kids still talk about it. It's definitely something unique and something I would highly recommend you do if you're looking for something this summer. And finally, then, just wanted to point out again, it's sort of a unique place to stay in Cork. It's called Cottages for Couples. It's really lovely stone barns and tree houses with hot tubs. And it's a really, really interesting place to stay. It's called Cottages for Couples. You'll see the photo there in the top of the screen. Definitely one that you should check out. So moving on to the Munster Vales, which is a region that covers Cork, Limerick, Waterford and Tipperary. And we had the pleasure of visiting this a couple of years ago. And there was really, I found so many hidden gems there and so many surprises. So both my parents were from Kerry. So I recall every single summer since I was, as far as I can remember, spending all our holidays in Kerry every year and never really going anywhere else. But we passed through Tipperary all the time. This is before there was the motorways down. We used to pass through Kerr and Nina all the way down, pass through Mitchellstown Cave, which is actually in Tipperary and not Cork, by the way. But we just never stopped. So it was really nice to have the opportunity to actually explore this area a few years ago. And I was amazed at what we found. Kerr particularly is just such a gorgeous little town. And Kerr Castle is definitely worth exploring. It's one of our best preserved castles. And there's a lovely walk, a 2 kilometre walk along the Shore Blueway down to Swiss Cottage, which you can see there. It's the top picture on the screen. It's a gorgeous little cottage that has been completely renovated. It was designed by John Nash, who designed Buckingham. He was the architect who designed Buckingham Palace. So, it's a real sort of hidden gem, and it's been beautifully restored. So that's definitely well worth a visit. And the Shore Blueway is all along there. It's 56 kilometres of walking and river experiences, and a 21 kilometre cycle route. So that stretches from Kerr through Clonmel down to Carrick on Shore. So there's an awful lot to do in that particular area. But what we did when we stayed there, we drove from Tipperary into Waterford and we drove over that V Pass. You'll see there the last photo on the screen. And this view is absolutely spectacular. It definitely must be one of Ireland's most scenic drives. And then we went on into Waterford and spent a few days in Waterford. We did the Waterford Greenway and all the top attractions. But one of the big surprises again for me was the Copper Coast. And again, it's something that it's another fabulous scenic drive, but there's some beautiful beaches along there. There's the Copper Coast Geopark as well. And yeah, a lot of experiences and a lot of sort of a part of Waterford that a lot of people probably don't discover. I've also just put up a photo there of Comishan Lake because I suppose we're all into hiking and outdoor pursuits at the moment, and it's certainly one of Ireland's top Instagram locations, and that is in the Cumrah Mountains, and it's definitely one for walkers or hikers to try because you will get just a spectacular view. So moving on to Limerick now, which is a county and city that's often overlooked. When you think that you're so central to Cork and Kerry and Clare, you're only actually an hour from the Cliffs of Moher from Limerick City. So it's a really good option if you're looking for reasonably priced hotels or you're having struggling getting availability on the coast. Limerick is definitely one to watch out for this summer. Limerick is also home to Ballyhora Country, which has Ireland's top mountain biking destination. There's 92 kilometres kilometres of biking trails there, the largest in the country. And when you think of Limerick City, which a lot of people don't sometimes think is to stay in, you forget that, you know, you're right on the River Shannon. You can do kayaking in front of King John's Castle there. It's really quite a gorgeous setting. And as I said, hotel prices are really reasonable and getting availability will be a lot easier than many of its neighbours. So moving on to the Lakelands and the Midlands too, which is definitely going to be key for this summer. And I do think we tend to forget that a lot of the activities we are looking for on the beaches can also be done on our lakes as well. So I know I mentioned Tipperary earlier, but as you can see on the map there, how far West Tipperary stretches over, right over as far as Clare. And there's a lovely little town there, there's two towns actually that meet together, Killaloe and Ballina, and they're on the shores of Loch Derg. And they both meet together there's a bridge crossing the two. So it's a really, really nice place to stay. Hotels are reasonably priced and you can do all the water-based activities there on Loch Derg. Also, when it comes to that area, Roscommon is often overlooked, and that is home to Lochee Forest Park, which is one of our best forest parks. Fantastic activities there, particularly for families. There's zip lines and segways and all sorts of things. There's also boat trips available, and you can camp and stay there too. So that whole region is definitely one to watch this summer, and I think the Lakelands are going to be huge. I've also just put in Kilronan Castle Hotel and Spa in there as well. They have lovely lodges on site, and a lot of their holiday homes or lodges, whatever you want to call them, and a lot of them are privately owned. So you will sometimes find them on the likes of Verbo or Airbnb, Booking.com, those kind of sites. And you'll see that, you know, you can use the facilities of the hotels, which I think at this stage it's very hard to find hotels that have lodges on site. But that might be one that's worth checking out. And sticking with the same theme, just to point out that Leitrim has 10 lakes. It's on the River Shannon, and it's a part of it is on the Wild Atlantic Way as well. So when you think of water-based activities, you know, don't forget about Leitrim. The Blue Way Water Park is there as well, which is one of our best water parks. It's an inflatable water park. Families would love that. And Loch Allen Adventure Centre is close by too. It's also home to Glencar Waterfall, as you can see there in the photos. So there's an awful lot to do in Leitrim. And as I said, it tends to be another one of those counties that's often overlooked. I also just put in a little photo of Ardnahoo Cabins there. Again, sort of relatively new. I think they opened last year, maybe the year before. Really gorgeous country eco cabins that look like a lovely spot to stay in. And of course, Loch Rinn Castle is there. So between, you know, Kilronan Castle in Roscommon and Loch Rinn Castle in Leitrim, some of these castles would be a lot more reasonably priced than if you were to stay in a castle in Galway or Clare or Kerry or something like that. So just moving west now along the coast, and I did leave out Galway and Clare and Kerry and some of our top counties just to try and focus on some of the places that you may not be aware of. So I just included some of our coastal counties, and Mayo is a personal favourite of mine. So let's get talking about that first. So Mayo has been in the headlines a lot this year, probably because Keen Bay is voted Ireland's best beach by Lonely Planet and one of the top 10 in Europe now as well. So yeah, a lot of the beaches may not be so hidden gems anymore, but I would definitely say if you're going to Mayo this summer, Achill is a must visit. And that Keen Bay, as you can see in the photos there, absolutely outstanding. Just make sure you get there early. And we were staying in Castlebar, which I think at the time was probably about an hour away. And we left early, but left about 9 o'clock in the morning. And when we got there, it was, as you can see, it was virtually empty. So if you are going, make sure you get there early. But there's lots more to Mayo than just Achill Island and Westport. Down Patrick Head, as you can see in the photo there, that's my little feet sitting there overlooking it, is spectacular. Definite visit. And we were there last July and it was very quiet. So certainly won't have anything like the crowds you'd expect on the Cliffs of Moher or anything like that. And that whole peninsula there, the Erris or Belmullet Peninsula, is stunning drive. There's some gorgeous, really unspoilt beaches, definitely worth checking out. And another place that really a lot of people weren't aware of when I mentioned it last year on our trip was the Great Western Greenway. I suppose the Great Western Greenway was actually built before the Waterford Greenway, and a lot of people say it was the inspiration for all the greenways popping up around the country. But it's 42 kilometres from Westport all the way to Achill Sound, so definitely for bike enthusiasts, that is definitely one to try this year. And if depending on where you're living or where you're coming back from, we're on from Dublin, so we were driving home from Dublin, and we decided to take the drive from Lewisburg and Mayo through Connemara and back to Dublin that way. And we drove through Duloc Valley. And when I say it's spectacular, I mean, I really, we were driving home, and as my husband kept saying, I just kept wanting to stop for more and more photos all the time. It's absolutely spectacular. And again, one of those hidden gems a lot of people don't know about. It's brings you right into the Lennan and Connemara, and is definitely worth checking out. Sligo is another one of those counties, if you really are looking for the Wild Atlantic Way, that you just may get lucky getting availability, because it doesn't tend to be as popular as some of the other counties. The beaches at Enniscrone and Streeta Beach are stunning, and the backdrop of Benbulbin Mountain and Classybon Castle. There's so much actually to do, and in Sligo, so many outdoor activities, and the scenery is fabulous. So definitely one to check out if you want a little pampering. The Voya seaweed baths are there too. You may be familiar with them if you're missing your travels. They're all on the Emirates plane and in lots of fancy hotels around the world. But they're here in Sligo, and you can take seaweed baths there on site. Also, just to point out that there's some really interesting accommodation options in Sligo too. Mark Rhee Castle is a smaller castle. I think it's about 30 rooms, and it was traditionally used for private functions, weddings, things like that. But they are open to visitors now, so that would be definitely one checking out. And something that you probably won't get available in July, August, but maybe for a different time of the year, that lighthouse penthouse is on my own personal bucket list. You can see the photo there. It overlooks Enniscrone Beach and looks absolutely stunning. And I've just put in Teapot Lane Glamping there too, because Teapot Lane Glamping is actually on the Sligo border, but the address is in Leitrim. So it tends to, people tend to, when they're looking for accommodation in Sligo, they may not see it initially, but you're really right on the border there, and that there's some really cool glamping facilities. So it's definitely worth, that one is worth having a look at too. And moving north to Donegal, where I am going this weekend, which I'm very excited about. So most people, when they think of Ireland's beaches, they may think of Clare or Kerry or Connemara maybe. But actually, Donegal has the most blue flag beaches in Ireland. And there are some places, you know, a little bit off the beaten track. So when you think of Donegal, you may be inclined to think of Bundoran and Killybegs and some of these more well-known regions. But the Inishowen Peninsula is definitely one to look at. It's where Malin Head is, and it's actually Ireland's largest peninsula. There's also a fabulous scenic drive there that I'm hoping to do myself this weekend. It's called the Inishowen 100. It's a 100-mile scenic drive around the coastline, and I'm told it's spectacular. Donegal is also home to Glenveagh National Park, which is Ireland's second largest national park. And of course, the Slievelee Cliffs are there. They're probably not a hidden gem anymore. But for those of you who don't know, they're actually three times higher than the Cliffs of Moher. And I can tell you there'll be a lot more than three times less crowds there. So definitely one to check out. There's lots of different, with all those blue flag beaches comes lots of water-based activities. And eco-Atlantic adventures are definitely one to watch. They have beautiful sunset kayaking tours. They've tours into cave tours as well. And there's also a lot of activities along. There's a lot of lakes in Donegal, so you can do a lot of supping and different activities on the lakes too. And one thing as well, just to note that, again, I'm hoping to visit, is Wild Ireland. It's Ireland's wildlife park, is located in Donegal, and it's a sanctuary for rescued animals. So there's bears and lynx and wolves and some kind of different animals you wouldn't expect to find in the zoo. And I'm told that's fabulous. That's a really, really good experience. I'm looking forward to trying. So moving on to Northern Ireland now, and obviously I can't talk about all six counties, but I am going to talk about two of my favourites, Antrim and Fermanagh. Antrim is a great destination for active people, whether it's families, great for teens as well. There's loads of adventure activities, there's loads of water sports there. So there's a huge amount to do. And what's lovely, particularly when you look at the Causeway Coast, is so many of the top attractions are really close together. So as much as I'd recommend you obviously take your time and take as long as you possibly can, it's very possible to see, to walk the Carrickreed Rope Bridge, see the Giant's Causeway and see Dunluce Castle in one day if you want to. All that coastline, all along that coastline is spectacular, the drive and the attractions. And there's lots of Game of Thrones filming locations there too. And fabulous beaches like White Rocks Beach. So yeah, it's definitely one of those coastlines that is one of my favourites in the country, and one I'd kind of highly recommend for everyone really, particularly people looking for outdoor activities. There's a great company there called Aquaholics, and they do coast steering, which is where you jump off the cliffs into the sea. They also do sea safaris, they do scuba diving, an awful lot going on there. And you can see there the photo on the last screen, and there is the Govan's Cliff Path Walk that was refurbished and newly opened again last year. We were supposed to visit actually, but unfortunately had to cancel with restrictions. I'm hoping to get back up there this summer. But it's a dramatic cliff path walk built into the side of rocks and caves, and there's tunnels and all sorts of really, really cool things. Probably not for the faint-hearted now, but looks really, really interesting, and definitely one of the most dramatic cliff path walks, I'd say, in Europe. And another thing about Belfast is, or another thing about Antrim, is that Belfast is absolutely superb to visit. There's so many attractions, so it's really good to combine some coastal activities with some city activities. Obviously we all, the Titanic doesn't, we all know about the Titanic exhibition, but the Black Cab tours will be very interesting as well, and there's lots of adventure activities available in Belfast too. Vertigo has indoor skydiving, and like this, yeah, I think you'd be surprised at the amount of activities and things to do in Belfast. And last but not least, Fermanagh. Fermanagh is a great alternative to the Shannon if you're looking for activities on the lakes. You can rent cruisers here, you can do all sorts of water-based activities, including, you'll see that picture of a girl on a hydro bike down there. There's so much to do, and the lakelands are so vast in Fermanagh, and it should be easier to get availability if you're trying to rent a cruiser in Fermanagh than it would be along the Shannon this summer. I've mentioned the hydro bikes. There's a great company there called Castle Archdale that rent them by the hour. I think they're like £15 per hour, but loads of different activities available there. And also Culca Mountain, of course, the Stairway to Heaven walk isn't a hidden gem, I suppose, at this stage, but it's definitely one that a lot of people are interested in doing. So Fermanagh is one of those great counties for the outdoors, and that combines lakes and hiking, walking experiences. Another thing to mention about Fermanagh is there's some really interesting places to stay in Fermanagh. You've probably seen the Finlock bubble domes there, the photo you can see of the bubble dome on screen. You may have heard about them, but you may not know where they're located. They're actually in Fermanagh. They're a couples only accommodation and a great place to see the Northern Lights if you happen to get that lucky. But also Lusty Beg Island, you can see in the top, is gorgeous cabins right on the lake. You have to get a boat out to them, and that's a really, really nice place to stay, and they're a 4-star property, so not outrageously expensive either. Also Lochearn Resort, the 5-star resort hotel, is there. So Fermanagh is surprisingly one of those counties that's not often talked about, but has a huge amount to offer. So as I mentioned earlier, I couldn't obviously cover all counties today, but I do have a post on my website, thetravelexpert.ie, that is an in-depth county by county guide to the hidden gems in Ireland, and all 32 counties are featured there. So would love you to check it out. So I hope you enjoyed that presentation. I gave you lots of travel inspiration, and hope you learned about a few places that you didn't know were available in Ireland and things available to do. So if you want to know more, I've got lots of articles on my website, thetravelexpert.ie, a whole section on holidays in Ireland. I've got travel deals in Ireland, and obviously I've got lots of inspiration for traveling abroad, and we can do that too. I'm also on all the major social media platforms. I'm on Facebook, Instagram, Twitter, so you can follow me there. It'd be great. and I do a regular newsletter every week. At the moment, I've been doing it every fortnight, but when overseas travel resumes, I'll probably go back to doing it weekly. It's a free newsletter. It goes out every Tuesday.
Brilliant. Thank you, Sarah, so much for that. It was absolutely amazing. So many fantastic tips that, I mean, I thought I was well travelled, but I now have a list of about 20 more places I want to visit. As Sarah mentioned, you can go to her website, thetravelexpert.ie, and follow her there. Her newsletter is fantastic. Now we have a special guest in studio or a backstage. You probably spotted our poll up on Twitter earlier. Rama Block, one of the amazing musicians that works for Music Generation Wicklow, and we are so excited to have him here. I saw your post on Twitter, I have it here, and we asked you to vote on what song you would like Rama to play. And the votes are in, and it's Mr. Blue Sky. Thanks a million, Rama. Take it away.
Thank you. You guys hearing that okay?
We're good, Rama. Go for it.
Sun is shining in the sky. There ain't a cloud inside. Stop raining. Everybody's out to play. And don't you know, it's a beautiful new day. Hey, hey. Running down the avenue, see how the sun shines brightly on the city, in the streets where once a pity Mr. Blue Sky is living here today. Hey, hey, Mr. Blue Sky, please tell us why we had to hide away for so long. When we go wrong, Mr. Blue Sky, please tell us why we had to hide away for so long. Where did we go wrong?
Next vote is in, Rama, and they want to hear Thinking Out Loud.
Thinking out loud. Okay, let me grab the guitar. Check we're in tune. Okay. When your legs don't work like they used to before, and I can't sweep you off of your feet, will your mouth still remember the taste of my love? Will your eyes still smile from your cheeks? Maybe I will be loving you till we're 70. Maybe my heart can still be as hard as 23. I'm thinking about how people fall in love in mysterious ways. Maybe it's the touch of a hand. Me, I fall in love with you every single day. I just want to show you I am. Maybe now. Take me into your loving arms. Kiss me under the light of a thousand stars. Place your head on my beating heart. Think it out loud. Maybe we found love right where we are. When my hair's all but gone and my memory fades, and the crowd don't remember my name, when my hand don't seem the same way, I know you will still love me the same. Baby, your soul it never grows old, it's evergreen. Baby, your smile forever on my mind and memory. I'm thinking about how people fall in love in mysterious ways. Maybe it's all part of a plan. Me, I keep on making the same mistakes, hoping that you'll understand. Baby, now, take me into your loving arms. Kiss me under the light of a thousand stars. Place your head on my beating heart. Thinking out loud, maybe we found love right where we are.
Coming up next, we might have Seven Nation Army.
Oh, excellent.
And there is also a vote that you should have your own show.
Thank you very much for that vote. Okay, Seven Nation Army. Seven Nation Army couldn't hold me back. I'm gonna rock 'em all, taking their time right behind my back. And I'm talking to myself at night like a cigarette. Back and forth through my mind, because I can't forget. And the reason's coming from my sound that I should find a home. Find a home. Hey, hey, hey. Oh.
Just looking again, scrolling back. I think people are dancing and singing.
Great.
What a lunchtime.
Lunchtime boogie.
Do you want to go with them? I want to break free.
Oh, yes, sure.
There was a lot of votes on Twitter.
I want to break free. I want to break free. I want to break free from your lies. You're so self-satisfied. I don't need you. I want to break free. God knows. God knows I want to break free.
fallen in love for the first time. This time I know it's for real. I've fallen in love. God knows I've fallen in love. Strange but it's true. I can't get over the way you love me like you do. But I've got to be sure when I walk out that door. Oh, how I want to be free. Oh, how I want to be free. Oh, how I want to break free. Womp, 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 womp. Womp, 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 womp. Life still goes on. I can't get used to living without and without and without you by my side. I don't want to live a love world. God knows I've got to make it on my own. God knows I've got to make it on my own. Girl, can't you see? God knows I want to break.
Oh, amazing.
I forgot to, like, having an audience there with that bit of wings as well.
Listen, there's some whispers backstage that you're working on a masterpiece. Bohemian Rhapsody.
Yes.
Yeah. And that's you could get a little taster.
Okay, how many have we got left?
We'd love a second masterpiece, Robin.
What's that?
We'd love a taster of that masterpiece.
Okay, I'll give that a go. Is this the last one? Because I would tend to do that one last.
Oh, okay.
Just because my voice would be wrecked after. I don't know if I'd be able to sing another one after it.
Okay, well then we'll
be short, happy.
Yeah, we'll start with happy.
Yeah. We better get that Wayne's World graphic going again once we get to Bohemian Rhapsody, isn't it?
Harry.
Might sound crazy what I'm about to say. So Jackie's here, you can take a break. Well, I'm a hot air balloon that can go to space. With an air like I don't care, baby, by the way. Cause I'm happy that I belong if you feel like a room without a roof. Cause I'm happy like a dawn if you know life. Happiness is the truth. Cause I'm happy like a dawn if you know what happiness means to you. Cause I'm happy like a dawn if you feel like that's what you wanna do. Here come and you talking this and that. Suck it to me, get your best shot. I should probably warn you, I'll be just fine. No offense to you, just don't waste your time. Cause I'm happy like a dog if you feel like a room without a roof. Cause I'm happy like a dog if you feel like happiness is the truth. Cause I'm happy like a dog if you know what happiness means to you. Cause I'm along if you feel like that's what you wanna do. Don't bring me down, camera. Bring me down, pull too high. Bring me down, camera. Bring me down, yeah. Bring me down, camera. Bring me down, my level's too high.
bring me down. Cause I'm happy, clap along if you feel like a room without a roof. Cause I'm happy, clap along if you feel like happiness is the truth. Cause I'm happy, clap along if you know what happiness means to you. Cause I'm happy, clap along if you feel like that's what you wanna do.
Brilliant. Thank you. Thank you, Emma. We're going to wrap up Wellbeing Wednesday. Thank you to the travel expert, Sarah Slattery. Thank you to ICEP for a great session on nature and resilience. And thanks, Rama, for that brilliant jukebox session. So we're going to finish up with Bohemian Rhapsody.
Okay. I'll give it a shot now. I tried this twice before and my voice was running out. So normally when I play this, everyone sings along, and it doesn't really matter what happens to my voice. So please, whoever's watching out there, make sure you're singing along, and hopefully I'll get away with it. Is this the real life? Is this just fantasy? Caught in a landslide, no escape from reality. Open your eyes, look up to the skies and see. I'm just a poor boy, I need no sympathy. I'm easy come, easy go, little high, little low. Any way the wind blows doesn't really matter to me, to me. Mama just killed a man, put my gun against his head, pulled my trigger, now he's dead. Mama, life has just begun. Now I've gone and thrown it all away. Mama, didn't mean to make you cry. You are not back again this time tomorrow. Carry on, carry on, till nothing really matters. Too late, my time has come. Send shivers down my spine, body's aching all the time. Goodbye, everybody, I've got to go. Gotta leave you all behind and face the truth. Mama, I don't want to die. Sometimes wish I'd never be born at all. I see a little silhouette of a man, Scaramouche, Scaramouche, with a little band, thunderbolt of lightning, very, very frightening. Galileo, 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 finger of my finger. Nobody loves me. He's just a poor boy from a poor family. He's sparing his life from this monstrosity. Easy come, easy go, when you get me. Fizz Milla, oh, we will not let you go. Let me go. Fizz Milla, we will not let you go. Let me go. Fizz Milla, we will not let you go. Let me go. We will not let you go. Let me go. We will not let you go. Let me go. Let you go. No, 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 no. Bum, bum,
me or let me go. Beelzebub has a devil book aside for me. For me. For me. So you think you can stop me, a spin in my eye. So you think you can love me and leave me to die. Whoa, baby, can't do this to me, baby. Just gotta get out, just gotta get right out of here.
Thank you so much, Rama.
Thanks, guys. Have a great rest of the week.